Thank you, Lasca Hirlach, and welcome the Minister to the House and welcome the opportunity to discuss this very important issue for Irish agriculture, beef farmers and rural Ireland in general. Minister, like yourself in your opening address, I won't be revisiting the beef sector agreement, as it's well documented, and I do feel that now is not the time for outside commentary on it from politicians or anyone else. I think the farm organisations, the farming community, need to be given some time to advocate what was agreed to their members, and I suppose the ultimate test of its success or otherwise will be down the road when we see how the outcomes affect the business or the sector or the trade going forward. I will just say, however, that, and while I accept the law that it was not possible for you during those talks to discuss price, base price is ultimately the bottom line here, I suppose, to kind of phrase. And while a lot of the agreement is based on bonus, a percentage of a base figure will determine what the bonus is, and the lower the base price, sometimes the bonus can become irrelevant and will not have a determining factor on the overall price to desired effect. While it was not possible and not legal, and I accept that possibly within the talks to discuss base price, I think a lot of the time in this conversation, base price can dominate the conversation, and in doing so overlook what is in essence the most important figure in any business model, farming being no different, and that is profit. And profit, as anyone who knows anything about business knows, profit is the margin between cost and sales price. And I suppose in this scenario, because of the cheap food policy, which CAP is and was introduced for, you have to factor in subsidy. So we have to think outside the box on this one. And with Brexit and Mercosur and climate action and all the I suppose the perfect storm that's building around the beef industry, we should be looking maybe sometimes at input costs and production costs. And why is there such a difference between base price and the production cost? And therein is where I think, Minister, yourself, the Department of Agriculture, and indeed Brussels to an extent through the payments, can have a big role to play. You, as Minister, and your department will play a very big part in CAP going forward, and have done in the CAP payments to date. And we've seen reductions in CAP payments through straight reductions and indeed convergence. And convergence is something I'd like to mention to you here today, and that I hope you can play a big role, especially now with the introduction of greater subsidiarity in CAP going forward. I'll speak specifically, I suppose, about suckler farmers in my own area, farther north and along the west coast. And their entitlements would have been based on payments that would have been received prior to the reference years. And with the 10 months, 20 months of the slaughter premium, they probably would have built up above average per hectare payments. But now, through convergence, these payments are being reduced, which is another blow in a sector that's in difficulty, being reduced and redistributed to people in other sectors who probably, by virtue of their geographical location or their farming type, have far greater farm holdings, have far more hectares of land. And it's a double whammy for the beef farmer that their proposed new CAP is going to be, from what we're hearing, reduced by 5%, but they may also lose some of their entitlement value through convergence. And I think this is one thing that you can address when it comes to their input costs. Another area which we're hearing a lot from the farmers about, and it's a key topic of debate at the moment, is the TB eradication programme. And there is an exorbitant cost on the Irish farmer in comparison to our neighbours in Northern Ireland, England, Wales and Scotland, when it comes to what it's costing the actual farmer to try and eradicate TB. So there again, it's costs. If we look at costs, as I say, in any business model, if you know the price you can gain for your commodity and you're not happy with your margin, you will then look at your input costs. And that's where I think you, your department and officials have a role to play. And while it may be illegal through competition authority rules to discuss price paid for a product, it's certainly not beyond the bounds of possibility that we can discuss and try and meet the farmers in reducing their input costs, which I believe at the end of the day will improve the margin. And it is at the end of the day all about margin. There are a couple of items which have been introduced to help, or were supposed to help, which I think did not have the desired effect. And I suppose, Beam, you mentioned it there yourself, Minister, the 50 million from Europe, which was matched by Exchequer funding here of 50 million, and you quoted the application numbers, and we now have a spend of 78 million out of that 100. So I'd like to know today, where will the 22 million go to that has not been applied for? And it was probably obvious from day one, once the conditions of that scheme were set, that there was going to be a shortfall in applicants. The conditions attached to the scheme, while it was a compensatory scheme for losses, and I know you will probably come back to me and say they were put on us by in Europe as a caveat when they were giving us the money. But if you take the 5% reduction in nitrogen output, which is in essence a 5% reduction in stock, the fact that the average size suckler farmer in Ireland is under 20 cows. We'll take a 20 cow farmer then as an example. It's basically a reduction of one cow. So he can apply for his 20 suckler cows, 20 40s. He'll be getting €800. But to achieve that one-off payment of €800, he has to sacrifice potentially one cow, which could, depending on breed and quality, produce a weanling for him that would realise €800 per annum going forward. So, like, that's nonsensical when the farmer sat down to think about it. Why would he take €800 in 2019 and give up a continuation of a potential €800 per annum going forward? So I think that, for one, was a condition too far. And the contradiction therein and the irony therein is that that reduction in Irish suckler herd beef is going to be replaced through Mercosur on the shelves of our European countries with 100,000 tonne of beef from South America, where they're taking down, cutting down and removing rainforest at the rate of Crow Park every minute. Like, the irony in there is unreal. If the condition that was put into the BEAM scheme is supposed to be, or supposedly, for climate reasons or climate action reasons. I think, Minister, and I know you'll probably come back and say the horse has bolted, the scheme has closed and you can't start changing conditions now, but I think you need to tell us where the 22 million is going, how it can be distributed. Now, if there had been an over-application, the payment rate was going to be reduced. So, by equal and opposite terms, does that mean because there's an under-subscription to the scheme that the initial base payment of €100 at €40 can be increased in a pro-rata fashion? I'd like to hear the answers on that. And I certainly, and I think the Commissioner is on record as saying, with Brexit coming down the line and the possibility of us looking for future market disturbance measures, that if we're seen not to spend the first one we achieved in its entirety, it certainly won't enhance our chances going forward. A number of other measures, Chairperson or Minister, that I'd like to address, and you mentioned them in your own address, is where you have competition, you will have price. And you rightly said that the main driver of competition within the beef sector in Ireland will be by maintaining live exports. I think we haven't taken enough action based on the experiences of the year gone by to increase our lairage facilities in Cherbourg. And it's vitally important. If we do not get the dairy calf off the island, we're going to continue the glut of beef and hence compressed price in the beef market going forward. Another area, Minister, which I think to address this issue, if we can think outside the box, and with Brexit coming down the line, and irrespective if there's no tariffs introduced, we don't know what way sterling is going to be treated in world markets, and the value of sterling will affect the price that we gain for our beef. We need to look at alternatives. And I think the beef farmer out there, when you're talking to them, genuinely realise there's an issue, and genuinely realise that their business is in crisis, and that they're open-minded to alternative complementary incomes. And microgeneration is one that is staring us all in the face. It would kill two birds with one stone. It would be contributing to our climate action targets. So I think you need to have a pat worn into Minister Bruton's office to prioritise the necessary changes to the grid and the metering, that farmers can put in solar panels on their sheds and complement, I won't say supplement, but complement their income, or at worst case scenario, reduce their energy costs. And this, as I say, would be killing the kind of phrase, two birds with one stone. It would be contributing to our renewable energy production. But it would help farmers in a thinking outside the box fashion to up their income when quite possibly beef prices are going to be compressed more through Brexit. I had a lot more, Minister, but the Lasca Hearluck is putting me under pressure here to stem down. So
the maybe, order of the House now.
Maybe I'll discuss them in a private capacity with you later. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much, Senator Daly. And